In a short while, it will be 1977. Jubilee year, and I'm sure all of you join with me in wishing Her Majesty a joyous and happy new year.
Well, you can see why the Druids have midsummer celebrations here at Stonehenge and not cold New Year's Eve celebrations. Mind you, they did have the good nature to leave a glass here for me and a magnum of champers, so I'll get stoned on this. Happy New Year.
These people share Britain's most common surname. They're all called Smith, and they've come here from all over the country. Together, they make up a statistical cross-section of the population. If you like, they're average British citizens. And because they are, it's likely that they'll represent the hopes, the fears and the attitudes that may or may not help to make 1977 a happy new year. Not only for them, but for all the rest of us too. Not that there's much chance of it being a particularly prosperous new year if the merchants of doom are to be believed.
We, the people of Britain, are all here, ready to grit our teeth and face whatever fate has in store for us in this year of 1977.
Sky. The year is going, let him go. Ring out the false, ring in the true. Ring out the narrowing lust of gold. Ring out the thousand wars of old. Ring in the thousand years of peace. Ring in the valiant man and free. The larger heart, the kindlier hand. Ring out the darkness of the land. As many of you probably know from the hangovers you're nursing right now, we really go for it in a big way on New Year's Eve. A kind of collective catharsis, blotting out all memories of the year gone by, to leave us with a blank slate to write on during the year ahead.
And it has been destroyed by lightning, earthquake and thunder, I say, what?
All years are special, some good, some bad. But in 1977, with the Labour Party leading us into another winter of discontent and Mrs. Thatcher waiting in the wings, more seemed at stake than usual. Perhaps even now it's not too late for us all to learn something from what went down back then.
1977 had more of a millennium feel than the millennium did. There was definitely something you could see changing culturally. There was a lot of anticipation about 1977, not only because of the stir that punk rock had created across the country, and also in the Rasta circles. The prophet, Marcus Garvey, had prophesied that when the two sevens clashed, there would be chaos. As it turned out, there wasn't chaos in Jamaica, but there sure was a lot of chaos in the United Kingdom. Two sevens did clash.
On New Year's Day 1977, a few months before they released their first album, The Clash officially opened the Roxy Club in Covent Garden and kick-started the year of the punk. In the weeks leading up to that gig, a no-budget film was being made about The Clash by a bunch of clueless amateurs, aborted, abandoned and banged up in a leaking shed for many decades the film was destined never to see the light of day. Now, nearly 40 years later, in times not so different from those we lived through back then, the film has risen once more from the cold vapors of the vault and again raised its ugly head for your viewing pleasure tonight.
This is the first time we've ever been filmed, you know what I mean?
We cringe a lot.
Yeah.
Don't my nose look picked?
Yeah. Can I be so ugly?
I think it's really good because it like, helps us as a group get our message across in another medium.
It's evidence of life.
Why don't you like doing things that are set up then, Joe?
I think it's stupid. I mean, I don't go around doing things like that normally, right? So why should I do it when you're around? It's stupid. Makes me feel like a tit, you know?
The film's any good then?
Oh yeah.
It's fantastic.
You can tell how good a film is by when you leave the cinema. If you're acting like the person in the film, you know, like cowboy film, I always go down the street for a few hours. Like, I do, you know. Bow-legged than that.
Taxi driver was great, because everyone come out, taxi driver, like, and they put their lapels up.
Yeah.
Everyone was doing it. The whole cinema was, like, walking down the street like this.
Like, it's like when you go to those Bruce Lee films, there's all people going down the street,
yeah.
Going, and it's like...
It is, true, yeah.
You don't mind being filmed as well?
No, I don't care. It's great, because, like, all kids, like, want to be on television or something and see themselves on the screen.
You've got to remember, no one had seen themselves on video before.
Great!
At a Paris studio.
Spin. Yeah. It looks like the calendars you get to the film.
It's
weird
to you.
Joe, watch me crash on the telly.
Hold on.
No, you're in the way. Okay, go. Yeah. Do it.
If you
want to
get it wider.
Fucking hell. First time
a mirror in space. What, like a mirror on the wall?
Well, like a
You look at it and you think, next time we go on stage, I'll do that more often. And it sort of helps you sort of like the show a lot better, you know, for the kids and all that.
Because we don't get a chance to see ourselves as often as we get a chance to see other groups.
But you wouldn't like to act at all?
We're not great actors.
Well, it's drummer. That needs something else.
I mean, I could see myself on the big screen, like a big star, like doing all the tough bits. Yeah, I wouldn't mind to make a film that wasn't boring in any way at all, but I can't be bothered to think about it.
Rising oil prices, a trade recession, failures in the money supply, both here and abroad, nearly 1.5 million out of work, standards of living dropping, and according to the worst of our Cassandras, democracy itself on the verge of collapse.
I honestly don't know what's going to happen next year. The situation is going to, as far as I can see, get worse and worse.
We rely upon the workers of this country and their trade unions. And that is the way in which this country is going to get through if it gets through.
Draw your sword on the fight.
I'm going to fight on. And I'm going to take this country through if I have half a chance.
The Clash prepared for the Roxy gig, holed up in the bollock freezing cold of rehearsals, a broken jukebox repair workshop in a British Rail goods yard behind the roundhouse on the wrong side of the tracks in Camden Town.
Seen it when you can hear the music, you know. But before, I've only been able to see our group on a silent, homemade sort of family Norfolk Broads type camera, you know? And you couldn't hear the music, it just looked like a bunch of lunatics all going like...
jumping about.
You know, like, and you can't hear the music.
To Geordie exiles in particular who can't get home for the New Year festivities, may I wish you a very happy time, and indeed to everyone everywhere from the Northeast, a very happy New Year to you.
I'm going to negotiate with the IMF, and I need your support to do it. It means sticking to the very painful cuts in public expenditure on which the government's already decided. That's what I'm going to negotiate for.
How serious do you think Britain's economic problems are at present? 76% said very serious, 18% said fairly serious. In other words, 94%, nearly all of us, feel that the situation is serious.
We all agree that the crisis is indeed serious.
Edward Smith of Cheshire, what do you think our solution in 1977 is to all our problems? Do you feel optimistic about the future?
I don't feel at all optimistic about the future.
What are you yourself going to do?
Well, if the situation doesn't improve, I would definitely think of going abroad and working abroad.
Overnight snow up to 5 inches in places closed part of the M6 motorway in Staffordshire earlier this morning. Police say icy conditions will make roads treacherous this evening.
I think it was the whole general atmosphere in England that's getting everybody down. That everybody seemed to spend all their time moaning and being unhappy.
Mrs. Marjorie Smith, can I come to you? How do you view 1977?
Even more depressed about it than I was in 1976 or 1975.
How about the visual image you got, the way you dress?
Yeah, this is something we really work on and something we really enjoy, you know. We want to look special, we want to look new, we want to look different, right? And like, it's all come from us. We don't go and shop and get it, because there isn't any shop you can get it. If there was, we probably would go and get it, because we're lazy, right?
It's too easy for them to go into the gym machine, right, get up new coat jeans when the old ones get too stinky.
What's this here?
Haven Wall. It's the title of our new hit.
Good guy, come on, this one's a fine hit.
Shall I see it on the floor?
You have to be down. What, Joe? Where do you want it? All over? All over.
Right. Anything special?
No, just blanket coverage.
Any pups want their clothes sprayed, Joe?
Yeah, I'll bring them. Oh, queue them up outside, right? It'll be Pete's Boutique. That's the offensive look. Like as if you've been rolling about in Greece for 3 weeks.
Right, John, really good thinking. That's it. Look at that, reacting.
Yeah, I think it's some sort of weird paint, yeah. Just try and get it as black as possible. I'm going to hammer something.
Give it a good hammering, John.
Tough year with industrial troubles and economic strife, and we've all had to tighten our belts just a little. So, from Birmingham, a very happy new year.
I don't think the outlook is so good. I think it's a rather depressing time to be having a baby rumour. It's the state of the world at the moment.
Mr. Frank Smith from the Midlands, how do you see 1977?
I don't really share the views of some of these people that it's as bad as we would have it believe. We flog on, we're employing 10% more people than we were last year.
Could I ask you, what is your job?
I make cups of tea. You've always got to have some form of refreshment.
What's your New Year's resolution?
Might sign you up smoking. You like that?
Give me that smoking.
So where are you living now?
Well, me and him sleep on that floor, and he lives with his grand in a council flat.
There's a whole generation arisen over the last 3 years. They're probably in 1972 were 13, now are 17. All these kids in this country are out of work as is. with very little future ahead of them as they see it, and they've had nothing.
We haven't got a lot going for us, and like, there ain't much future for us. Like, just as people, not talking about being a pop group, just as people in the first instance, you know, come out of school, do a bit of college if you're lucky, get bored with it.
What do you all do before this? Where'd you start out?
The school I went to, right, it's a real sort of depressing school in there. You don't learn nothing. All you're sort of like working for is just to go into the factory, which is around the corner. Most of the mates I know are all working in the factory.
What kind of jobs have you locked up?
I was cleaning toilets in an opera house.
I'm a student. I'm an art student, man. Like, I've read Pete Townsend and Pete Richard.
In the box.
And John Lennon. And all them people were gone, right?
It's because art school became respectable, isn't it?
Turn to your right. Then to your left.
And I just realised I made a mistake. And I just, like, thought it was better than work.
All you get there now is, like, vicar's daughters and doctor's sons, yeah, you know?
Get rich kids getting a lift in the rolls to the end of the road, right? And then walking out and pretending to be poor all day.
I'll go like this.
Which I went to, right? The government paid for me to go there, and it was a private art college. And like, all you used to do all the time was just go around nicking all their paint. And like, going out with the birds, right, and going up to their houses.
Getting fed.
And like, getting fed. Fucking great. And like, on the way out, maybe sort of borrow something for a time.
Go and treat yourself to an Ilklymore cocktail for New Year. Take a little ice, fern to taste. Whiskey and
they didn't say the whiskey would freeze. Oh well, happy New Year.
George Smith, you come from Strathclyde. How do they feel about things up in Scotland? Who do they blame there?
I think actually the poor, the workers, the unions, the management and government, I think have all got to take their share of the blame.
I put it down to communism occupying very senior positions in the country. Like, if they want to go and live in Russia and communist country, let them bloody well go and live there.
If you just decided to work a little more, just decided to have a little more discipline, you could become the strongest country in Europe.
Situation has been created whereby boredom has set in amongst young kids without having really a musical expression of their own. If those kids have to watch Top of the Pops and see some old fart doing it, then what the hell is it to do with them?
Into my eyes and give me that smile, the one that always turns me on.
The explosion that's been caused in London has probably arisen out of seeing one band, I think the Sex Pistols, doing it, and all of a sudden, you know, it's like a little spark just sets everything alight, and it set things alight. It gave people fantastic inspiration, young kids, and they all felt, well, yeah, if a guy can get up there and play four or five chords and make it meaningful because there's a guy up there saying something with it, then what the fuck, man, if we identify with that, then we can also find the same spirit to do likewise.
Punk rock is the most immediate art form I can get whatever I've got to say across as quick as possible. You get this whole explosion of, like, new groups and media saying, yeah, they're kicking out the rock establishment. Let's call it the new wave. Let's call it punk rock.
I got a feeling inside of me. It's kind of strange, like the stormy sea. I don't know why, I don't know why.
The whole idea of getting on a stage and asserting yourself and announcing something is the criteria. It was inevitable that it should happen.
Can you just hold it in between? Yeah, like that.
You've got this rehearsal place here, right?
Subway Set use it. Sid Vicious and his new group use it. And like Keith Levine, who used to be a guitarist, he's going to use it. And the Slits are using it.
We used to like do such things.
When we first saw the Who on Ready, Steady, Go, right, when we was like babies, right? I mean, like, it looked great, you know, like, we could dig it, you know. But now, I mean, I couldn't understand even what Tommy was about. Tommy went over my head, you know. And we want to make records, and we want to be number one. I mean, I think we're the greatest, obviously, I want us to be number one.
So you want to blow up all those old bands, but how radically changed do you want in the system itself?
As much change as we can get.
Total change, I mean. We really think government is old-fashioned idea.
The whole of Britain was like a load of shit, right? There was nothing interesting going on, right? So, like, we created our own interesting things, right?
Thank you.
We're out to encourage people to be creative and make people aware. I mean, if that means we stuff it down their throat, we will stuff it down their throat until they know.
We're here from the magnificent 7-7 bridge, spanning as it does a very cold river, 7-7. We in the West Region wish you a very, very happy new year. And we do it in the traditional way, as we should, with Scrumpy. Happy new year.
Smith.
Politicians fundamentally are responsible for running the country. Perhaps we get the politicians that we deserve, but unfortunately politicians don't seem to be very good on either side at in fact doing the job that they're elected to do at the moment.
Oh, shut up! What a lot of old
Happy New Year!
Happy New Year!
I went to see my father the other day and he bought a copy of The Merlin Maker. And he said, what's all this punk rock then, son?
The media provides you with clichés to fall back on if you haven't got an idea in your head. I was down the dole Friday morning. What state this country's in? These are the things that, like, intelligent people know. If you can't, like, think your way out of a paper bag, read a paper, right? Baby drama of knife maniac. Then you go, oh, yeah, he's a knife maniac, right? And he's like, the knife maniac. The dull Q rock. You know what I mean?
In the news of the world, the punk goddesses,
punk esses,
and they make the Sex Pistols look like Proud Boys. They saw the Pistols on TV, and that was a bit scandalous because they said fuck. I mean, you know, everyone says fuck. You know, so they immediately, one man kicks at his TV, and the whole thing has been completely blown apart.
Prophecy!
They showed us all up to look really stupid. It looked like we were all really mindless, and we went around saying fucking hell, and we had safety pins in our ears and through our jaws and things. It didn't make us look like a force to be reckoned with, it just made us look like a load of stupid kids. We're kids, but, you know, we're not stupid.
There's a lot of kids from out of town coming in with the safety pins and all the business. The media pick up on the really weird things in the scene. Safety pins, plastic trousers, spitting. But that's just a fashion thing, you know? I think a lot of people are realising that it's not a fashion anymore. I think it's too serious musically.
Well, you know, some people drink to get high. I've come up high to our side of the Severn Bridge to have a drink and to wish all of you a very happy new year from us in Wales. Lwy the newydd dda I chi gyd.
We are worried because I wouldn't like to see the bread going up.
Oh, no. The meat, oh, that's terrible, isn't it?
We don't get much meat. I haven't seen beef for a very long, long time.
It was never spoken. It was never like we're going to consciously attempt to smash the musical, like, kind of establishment. But, like, that's what it is. We said, let's get a band together. Better than them bands. You know, otherwise what we'd do is we'd go and maybe go and shoot them. Plot an assassination.
And you've got to have destruction before you can, like, start anything new, right? I think the Pistols have, like, are destroying everything really fine in a really good way, right? And then after that, you've got to have something coming up.
The Sex Pistols are an idea. The idea is to threaten. The idea is to not allow conformity and not allow boredom to take place within your act. The idea is to say something that would change kids' actual outlook on their lives.
The Sex Pistol Anarchy Tour. I mean, like, fucking hell. Talk about overreaction, you know.
I mean, if it was 30 dates, 26 of them got cancelled, you know.
Anything new, they don't understand, they're afraid of. It threatens their whole existence, doesn't it?
Well, as soon as the Sex Pistols don't become threatening, they ain't no longer the Sex Pistols.
Fuck off!
They must threaten the culture and use it and change it, make it something else. Then we have a whole new scene on our hands.
Pistols decide not to play to the old stiffs. And I thought it was quite good. So why the fuck should they?
No, you don't do that sort of thing.
Oh, right. So they want it all over the country, wouldn't they? So we have to go out and find places to play. Like, we're really trying to get new places to go. Like, there's some guy opening up a new club down in Deal Street in Covent Garden. Roxy Club.
Neil Street, yeah.
Neil Street, is it? Covent Garden.
Covent Garden, epicentre of Cockney London. First neighbourhood to succumb to the dread tentacles of gentrification. Home to the infamous Roxy Club, heart of libertine London, where high and low culture have always famously collided, cavorted and clashed.
Morning, Patsy. How are you?
What do you want?
Got any good sprouts? Anyway,
yeah, terrific.
Where are they?
Yeah, I'm just in the shop here.
Well, hello, Vicky. What are you doing here?
What are you?
I'm having lunch with Boris Lermontov. You know, the fellow who runs the ballet.
Here for centuries, opera, theatre and ballet cohabited with the fruit and veg market next door. Ballerinas and baritones. Divas, prima donnas and matinee idols. All rubbing elbows with the Cockney costermongers and porters in the garden's boozers and caps.
At the gate are all the horses.
How much, Steph? £5?
£5.10.
Oh, leave it out. How much is Tom?
A royal pleasure ground where princes, punks and wicked earls shared beds with the whores of Paris's list and Mother Cresswell's brothel.
She's in the king's arms already, calling for beer.
Here Charles met Nell, Sid met Nancy, and Eliza Doolittle and Henry Higgins first misconstrued each other beneath the great portico of the Actors' Church, as depicted in My Fair Lady.
Want a few melons, will you?
Yeah, I could do. Yeah, what you got? And these were the other day, weren't they?
Yeah.
Good melons, as it happens.
What a coil do I make for the loss of my punk. I storm and I roar and I fall in a rage. And missing my whore, I bugger my page.
What's your favourite food?
A fine bitter.
Well then, what keeps you going?
Beer.
Birthplace of Punch and Judy, Turner, and the Muffin Man, who lived on Drury Lane. Filching pitch of Fagin and the Artful Dodger, host to the infamous trials of Oscar Wilde, Dr. Crippen, and the Brothers Cray. A topsy-turvy place where rhubarbs and turnips were traded in the dead of night, and the market pubs opened their doors at 4 in the morning.
Film star type of people, they like to come here and slum, you might say, and see the boys, you know.
3 rum and coffees.
I remember the time once when Elizabeth Taylor and Michael Wilding was in this very pub, dancing and singing, really enjoying themselves with the boys, you know. Because this is streets where anybody could come. Wonderful atmosphere.
For over 300 years, Covent Garden had all this and more, until the over-congested market was finally closed down in 1974. Right up until New Year's Eve, the Clash frantically auditioned drummers in their rehearsals ridout in Camden Town. Their regular drummer, Terry Chimes, or Tory Crimes, as Joe fondly nicknamed him, had had enough of Bernie's Clash course re-education programme and was refusing to commit to play the Roxy gig.
Everything we do, we try and be honest, right? Sometimes we don't make it, sometimes we do.
How hard do you work at what you're doing?
Oh, all the time, nothing else.
I don't think about anything else. I don't have time to.
They went through 20 drummers, including John Moss, who went on to drum for Culture Club, still half hoping that Terry would change his mind, before settling on a temporary replacement in Rob Harper, who was reportedly scarred for life by the experience.
Let's do that again, just rhythm, I mean, just no singing, right? Because I want the drum a bit clumsy or something.
To Norfolk have been perplexed on New Year's Eve to find their newfound neighbours hurling chunks of coal at their front doors. But it's not East Anglian vandalism, it's just our way of saying happiness and good luck for the coming year.
This country has been sitting on its laurels a bit too long. It wants a jolt to pull the people together. Nobody thinks about anybody else today. Everybody thinks just of themselves. The I'm all right, Jack attitude, which is all wrong.
Leonard Smith, what's the cause of the crisis?
I think small things that happen at school, perhaps. A child will perhaps cheek his teacher. And then it goes up from that. A man then becomes insulting to his boss. His boss sacks him, and then he's got problems there.
Tom, how many pubs did you get through in the night?
4 pubs and about 18 pints, I suppose.
Yeah, we are. Left, no. Yeah. There's me, and there's Mick, and there's Paul. And there's a guy with a camera and a guy with a pair of earphones. Sorry, what? Because we're filming.
Ask about Terry.
Yeah, of course he is. What about, you know, the guy in Hackney? Oh, yeah. Oh, have you? Good news, boys. But you won't tell it to me.
Tell it. Come on, it's really important.
OK, yeah. So we'll go down there and then come back, all right? Oh, yeah, that's what I mean. We're going to go down and do it and then come back, all right? Right.
When the punk rock business was starting up and groups wanted to play, they were rejected by everybody and everywhere. So the obvious thing was to try and find a place yourself. This I did by finding a club called the Roxy Club.
Bernie Rhodes and the Clash came down and I said, you know, how about playing? So we booked them in for January the 1st, 77. At the time that we took it on, it was called Shagoramas, and the name says everything about the gayness of it. It was a pretty hardcore cruising place.
You know who used to go to Shagorama? Sid used to go there. And he was John Beverly there.
They really couldn't care less who they rented it to, especially a bunch of noisy young people, because they just said, well, we rented you for a year and we'll see what happens. They were planning to knock it down. Covent Garden was shut down and it was derelict. It hadn't been used for 2 or 3 years.
Become a kind of wasteland, an inner city wasteland, where all these subterranean characters would emerge. You know, we're talking about gangsters and hookers and drug dealers and things like that. So it was a pretty scary place in the late 70s.
There's no domestic atmosphere around here now. All the residents have been gradually hived off and drifted away. At one time you used to see many more people about.
Bit of person, arrows on the block. This is going to happen in Shoreditch, in Lewisham, in other parts of Camden. They've got no interest in us. The almighty dollar, to call it the pound, is going to just throw us off. We're going to be nothing. We've washed us off.
When the Roxy opened January the 1st, 1977, for 100 days, it really was the centre of the punk rock universe.
I could go to the Roxy on the Piccadilly line, which is quite a way out, so it took me nearly an hour. I'd just get off at Covent Garden or Leicester Square if I was meeting my boyfriend. Covent Garden at the time was quite gloomy, Dickensian. You know, there were lots of lonely cobbled side streets and things. So I actually found it a bit spooky. And I actually found it quite scary to walk around on your own, just two of you. It was a much more seedy, dirty place than it is now.
We can eat when we get back there. We can send out other stuff, right?
You can get some tea sent over, Ben. It's not.
Well, if you like.
When the Roxy opened, it was a dingy basement, low ceilings, bench seats around the outside. To be honest, it was pretty much a shit.
One, two. Can I hear myself? Of course I can. Why do I get the dodgy stand?
They had a mirror at the Roxy at the back.
No, I didn't notice it. Wish I had. I was watching the girl in front of it.
And they're supposed to fall down all the time. Oh, hey, Mick, see these boxes? What are they? Is it just...
set of monitors, you stupid cunt.
Can't we stuff them somewhere else?
When the Clash finally got to the Roxy, they found the PA they had hired was up the spout. But it was New Year's Day, and too late to find a replacement. The show had to go on.
How much money do you make from your gigs?
We ain't getting
it. We don't really get it.
Don't get it.
Most of it goes on PA, you know?
Well, we want to get
work it out for yourself. 60 quid for a booking, right?
Yeah.
PA hire, good PA, right? We're a loud group, we need good PA. 55 quid, right? So you got 5 quid left, right? And I use a set of strings at night because I'm a vicious guitar player, you know? You want a drink or something to eat and... they are over the top in the red.
So what, yeah, we might have lost.
Where does the rest come from?
Well, it's been provided, isn't it? By our generous manager.
Our manager put mine up.
Every time we do a gig, he has to usually reach in his pocket.
We're in Devon.
Like most other places in Britain, we would wish you a very happy new year. But here in Cornwall, we'd say, Blethyn knoweth da.
Roy Smith from Bodmin.
Say down in Cornwall, and that the average wage is far below the standard of people here in London. And if you become unemployed, you get more through being unemployed than what you do if you're actually earning your living. So where's the incentive to work?
Any resolutions?
Do less work.
Anybody who was around at that time was there. You had everybody there. The only person who never came down was Malcolm, because I think he sometimes felt that he had some sort of right to this kind of thing.
He
I mean, I was the DJ from the minute the Roxy opened to the minute it closed. I do my dub-heavy reggae sets in between the fast and furious punk sets.
There was no real punk records around. It was Don diving into his collection, and magically it worked.
I'm playing hardcore dub reggae, which seemed to strike a chord with the white youth.
Oh, some decent fucking music at last!
Oh, Richie.
Most punks couldn't roll their own spliffs. So my dread brethren came up with a spliff factory and they sell re-roll spliffs from behind the Roxy bar.
I'm a raging queen, really. Don't tell anyone that.
We're doing something that we want to do. By playing, I'm doing everything I want to do. That's why I started playing. One day I didn't play, and the next day I did play. When I'm playing in a group and things are going on, I feel like as if I'm doing something good, you know? I mean, it goes up and down, but I mean, so is everything.
If your life is like a group, you play with the guys you dig, right? And you forget about the blokes who are like arseholes. If you're a bozo and an arsehole, you're an arsehole. You know what I mean? Like, you come on like an arsehole. You say hello, and like, they don't say hello, they say I'm an arsehole. I just happen to be meeting more of them at the moment.
Please, I try so hard to be nice.
A lot of the punks didn't walk the streets like that because they actually had to go to work. Every day I get... Then you finish your work at 5 or 6 or whatever, get a bag full of clothes, queuing up at 7 o'clock to get in, straight into the toilets, and the whole of the, all the toilets just change into this massive girls' changing room. So they're in there for like an hour or two, making up, gossiping, and just sitting there having a laugh.
Invariably the walls would be dripping with sweat, the place would be stinking with ganja fumes. I always remember the young punks were always jacking speed.
Do you have any resolutions?
Just simply to stop spending money.
This is Christine Smith.
Capable of the economic miracle? Certainly we are. We believe that.
Duncan Smith from Knightsbridge. How bad is it?
There is, at this moment, I would say blind panic. Everybody's trying to get every spare halfpenny they can out of the country by one method or another.
Is this happening on a big scale?
Massive scale. Absolutely enormous.
Nigel Smith from Surbiton.
Have you ever been tempted to change your sterling in some other currency?
Very much so. Well, anyone who's in the position to do so, they're very foolish not to be able to do so.
Lionel Smith from Finchley.
How do you feel about people who move their money abroad against the regulations of exchange control?
Criminal.
Despite their PA being on the blink, the Clash had committed to playing two sets that night as the new year was ushered in. On one big fiery flying roll, the Clash roared through all the key songs that would feature on their breakthrough first album a few months later. As the clock ticked down to midnight, they tossed them out like firecrackers into the crowd, kick-starting the year of the Clash.
Hey, Mickey, I have to make that work.
What do you feel like when you go on stage?
A pair of tits. No, I don't know, I feel good, you know. I mean, that's what we're supposed to do, you know. When we go on stage, I mean, that's when we like it best, you know. You can't get bored on stage, really.
Yeah, we're the Clash!
I'm not fired!
Bye.
my life. Great traffic system, it's so bright. Just think of a better way to spend the night. Spinning around, I'm having a yellow light. Love is fine, follow me.
I wrote it in a old sort of disused house near the Westway, and then I went up to see Mick Jones in the block, and like we kind of whipped it into shape up in his flat, and it was kind of like a quick one, you know, like you think of it, write it, finish it, and it was all over quick. It's just like not having anything to do, like not having no place to go. And you just think of a desert. The only activity I could see was like the moving lights going up and down the motorway and like going down the subways and looking at the writing. And it's like Wednesday night and it's the same as Thursday night or Friday night. I just felt the whole place was like bored as hell driving about and watching TV and stuff. So it's like London was burning with boredom. I wrote it to get rid of that feeling.
I love the empty stone, cause I'm all alone.
Do you think it could be any different?
Of course it could. It could get better, it could get worse.
I mean, what's going to make it get better?
More lunatic personalities actually doing things. More people doing honest things and not, like, trying to pose or ponce about.
What do you mean by honest?
Just to do with something. Mean something. To feel something so bad about something that you do something about it.
Group writes the songs. Joe's better than Lewis. I mean, he's great. Fantastic turn of phrase. You know? He's always taking notes. When it comes down to the tunes, I nick them.
We want to make them, like, vomit or something. I don't know.
I think move them in some way.
Anyway.
So that they can, like, get a reaction. Yeah, so that they can, like, perhaps, like, move themselves. I think it hits them the next morning. They get their moment to think about it. It will last them to at least lunchtime. Yeah. That day, I should think.
I've got to say, the PA don't sound so hot, you know? Because, like, we've got to test these things out, you know? Like, we can't just stand and look at it.
Use your imagination.
You know what I mean? We've got to, like, bring it to some gig and try it out. And if it don't work, what the fuck can you do but get on with it?
Like, you notice that how London belongs to Arabs and Yanks, you know what I mean? Hamburgers and whatever Arabs do, I mean. Things that go on in American politics, like everyone buying everybody else up and like the Watergate tape just keep on happening.
Well, I'm not a crook.
You know what I mean? Like exposing more and more and more. Like the further you dig down in America, like the more poxy it gets, you know. I'm dead sure it's a whole veneer on top of the whole thing. Like the whole thing is like filthy things going on down there. Just disgusting.
Who wants to wait an hour for King Kong to appear? I should have called it King Kong.
Texas Chainsaw Massacre.
Oh, John, I think I care about your latest record. I've been by the grateful dead.
I used to listen, you know, when I first started playing the guitar, to like American music, like blues music and Chuck Berry music and Bo Diddley music. And then you listen to like people from the 60s copying their accent just dead centre. Like Mick Jagger sounds just like Bo Diddley. So it's what a cornball thing it is to do to go on about my automobile doing 95, boom with a boom, boom, side, side, you know, all that shit. You just think how corny it is, and like, but it don't get you anywhere, you know what I mean? You just think it's stupid after that. So you get bored with it.
Look at that show!
What's been happening with that song, I've been coming up with like loads and loads of new verses for it. I can only take four verses a song, right? I keep coming up with loads and loads and like whopping new verses in there. It just gets closer every time. But sooner or later it'll stop and that'll be dead centre. And then you leave it.
When they're written down, they don't have any life. That's a replica of what it is, right? What it is when you hear it. That's the it. It ain't a poem or anything. You might want to hear them in the air.
On the dole since leaving school, Carol Donnelly had nothing to do but go blackberrying with her boyfriend.
It just seems a waste of time, you know, to spend 4 years in this place for the government to have pumped in so many thousands of pounds and actually training me to supposedly be somebody who can go out and do a specific sort of job. It seems a waste of money to, at the end of it, just to put me on the dole queue.
Teaching, local government, hospital administration, public services and industry have all had to cut their intakes, and I know how much harder it is to get your first job.
How much extra unemployment will your additional and immediate cuts in public expenditure add to the already rising total of unemployment?
Very, very little indeed.
What do you
very,
call?
Very, very small.
What do you call?
Very small indeed.
What do you call a very little unemployment? Are we talking about another 100,000, another 500,000?
Oh, no, less than that. Less than that.
Well, I think it's a comedy number. Career opportunity is the one that never knocks. It's like a great line, right? Get a job, you know. And like we thought it was a great subject just because all the time you spend in them offices, like going in and out of those boards plastered with jobs, like evening work, tailor's work, toilet work, shift work, part work, a poster at the end saying, come and join us, you know, traffic warden, so come and join us, be a man with the police. It kind of like has an effect on you, you know what I mean? You just realise that if people are working and got their nose in the factory for like
40 hours of a week, right, they're going to be less harmless than someone who doesn't have his nose in the factory for 40 hours a week, right? So that's what jobs is for. I was on the Dole, right? I hadn't been on there long, say 6 months. I'm quite happy, right? Really getting something going with this group and really writing a load of stuff and playing the guitar, right? I'm quite happy. And they called me in there and they said, "You haven't got a job." And I said, "No." And they said, "Are you looking?" I said, "Yeah, sure. I look in all the papers. Oh, yeah. So I just got to sit there and he's got to say, "Well, look, right, in 4 weeks we'll send you to this rehabilitation centre." I said, "The what?" And he says, "Yeah, it's a pamphlet." And it says, like, you get up at 7 a.m, make your bed, shave. You got your own cubicle, you go out and you have first work period, and then you have a lunch period and play snooker and darts, and then you have a second work period, and then you can watch TV and go to bed. And it's to get you back to a working routine. It's not teaching you a trade. I said, "I don't want to go." And he says, "You haven't got any choice." I just thought, this is like robot school, you know what I mean? Like programming. So like, I had to cut out.
You go around the job centre, you take out a job, you go down there, see 3, 4, 5, 6 people in front of you, and they come in and say, "Sorry, son, there's no vacancy." It's depressing. Something's got to happen, you know what I mean? Otherwise, you'd love to do something that you regret.
To me, it's about breaking sort of like old rules. All this, you should do this, you should go to work. It's about finally saying, look, no, we shouldn't do this because Britain's fucked up, it's going down the drain. Yet still people are saying, well, you should have a good job. You know, if Britain's going down the drain, I don't care, you know. Yeah, it's like these people make me sick.
You know what I'm talking about? Sound, you know. Rafola. What?
Pop tune because it's got like good rhythm. It's just 5 minutes on a Wednesday night and your mind's of some skull-brained idiot working in the city. You know? A quick flash in his dopey bucket head. Stuff like cars and girlfriends and Janie Jones and Paola and their jobs and their boss and what he feels but he daren't say it, you know what I mean? He feels he's got some grudge but he daren't say it. I look at everybody. I see everybody. What else is there to look at?
It's really great looking at the audience, like, it's like looking at their faces and that, right? And they sort of like look at you, right? You think, oh, great, you know, it sort of like makes you like more like one.
You don't look at your instrument that much, do you?
That's the trick, right? You've got to learn to play it without looking at it, right? Because nothing looks worse than some bunch of
wankers, right, where everyone's going, you know what I mean?
Standing like that
guy. Oh, it's terrible.
Oh, yeah. You can, that's me.
No, you can do it pretty good without. I mean, I have to look every 10 seconds or so, a quick look, to see that you're on the target, you know? You know, the rock and roll world. You know, the music world. You know, we're getting out of world.
Suddenly you're getting an awful lot of energy that you might get from a Led Zeppelin or from a heavy metal band that was coming across the footlights from this little stage tucked away in the Roxy.
The money merchants are here. The guys who are flashing the greenbacks are here. And they want a piece of the action. Which is the only reason why I seem to be meeting more the guys who, like, know nothing.
I think the rock and roll world is a fucking waste of time. I have no interest in it. I think it's over.
I started going places where the youngsters shouldn't go. I got to know the kind of girls it's better not to know.
I think the industry took over a long time ago.
I don't know who they're speaking for. I certainly don't think they're speaking for the kids in the street.
Every rebel always says he doesn't want to become part of the establishment, and this is nothing new. On the other hand, there are bands that recognize that what they're in the business for is the music that that they're making, and the place for them to get the widest audience with a record company that can merchandise, market, expose them to the widest public.
All of a sudden, all the groups are Sunshine Breakfasts. Their main objective is to sell cornflakes. Ours is to move forward. We had nothing in common.
No question. We had to rethink whether we were capable as people to judge what the what our audience who buy our records wanted.
Isn't it possible that just by signing you get incorporated into the system?
You watch what you sign. Mm-hmm. Obviously, you've got to do it on your own terms. Like, if I wouldn't sign a record contract that said that you've got to sing old hits by Jonathan King
and appear on the Lulu show in white Wellington boots.
Yeah, you know I mean, like, we just wouldn't do it.
Selling out. It's just what the record company's doing.
Right.
It's, I mean, that's all it is. There's still a revolution and that's what I'm about. There's still trouble in this country. There's still fucking a lot to shout about.
How do you see your future in this society?
Not a bright and shining future, not as I am, because I am black to the point of being offensive. It's as simple as that.
Times were tough on the street. I mean, they were tough for me because I was black. But it was also tough for my white mates. There was this feeling that something had to change. And I think one of the first signposts were the riots of 1976 in Nottingham Carnival, where the black people were saying, you know, OK, we've had enough. It was a wrong and right thing. And it was black kids and white kids against the cops.
Me and Bernie and Paul went down the carnival right in the middle of it. Suddenly, this conga line of policemen moved right in front of us, and then someone slung a Coke can at them, and then the whole thing flared up right in front of our noses. Like.
The side we were on really was anti-status quo. We were on the black guy's side.
Gate crashing their riot. Coke can started coming over until it was like rain, you know. And like Bernie got clumped around the head by some sort of nasty policeman and lost his glasses. And it was getting really heavy.
night fell and there wasn't hardly any white people left, just the ring of troops around the edge of the grove, right, and all these blacks in the middle. The guy came up to me and I had a transistor radio in my pocket and he slapped it and he said, "What you got to do, man?" Right? And suddenly there was like a ring of about 20 of them around me and Paul. And I told him to leave it out. The police were getting ready to charge down the other end of the street. And I had a bottle in my other pocket, so I brought it out. And I said, "You should be picking these up, you know, not bothering about what I've got in my pocket." Paul kind of, after that, we trudged home, like, dejected, right? We got home, we had a cup of tea, like, we weren't saying anything, right? And it kind of felt bad, somehow, to get done by both sides of a riot, you know what I mean? Like, but, like, I just realised that that was other man's business. So, like, I just sort of wrote about a riot, because I feel that bad, really. But, like, no one feels bad enough to have a white title riot, right? About what we've got to beef about. It's kind of like a dig at white people because everyone's like got a nice paycheck or it's got enough dope or you know what I mean? Like everyone's like just piddling about really.
White Riot, yeah, the lyrics were definitely misinterpreted by those that were keen to misinterpret it. It was almost stolen by the National Front. But in truth, what Joe's saying is, look, you know, black people have got a lot of problems, but they deal with it. You know, they'll pick up a brick and get involved. And it's about time that we get involved as well. That's what he was on about.
Everyone thinks we're a fascist group, right? And we're supposed to be anti-fascist, right? And even the fucking National Front are going to turn out to support us, right? So I don't care to fucking sign anti-fascist things, as long as it clarifies the issue.
I think there's a lot of confusion. People who wear Nazi armbands and that, they don't know what it means. It don't mean anything to the kids who wear it. But I think there's a danger there that National Front could move in there and have all them kids, like, vote for us, you know? Just sort of an ignorant situation.
So how do you define yourselves politically?
Anti-fascist.
Now listen, I want you to go out there and give this fella some stick. Oh, you do smell lovely.
She will tell me where you get the smelly stuff from.
It's the 70s, you know, everything was so bad in the 70s. It is ironic, really, the music's here because of that, you know, sort of crap what's going on. It's so sick, Britain now, or anywhere. It's all business, it's all tied up, just like the EMI thing, just like the media thing on the punk. It's just ridiculous. There's no honesty anywhere. You can't trust anyone, you know. And that's why, to me, the music is happening. It's the attitude of saying, look, we're going to forget everything. Because we want to get back to honesty, you know.
Help me make it through the night.
Big business and the government are like stacked against anyone. Every time you go in a cafe, the prices are up a bit. So it just gets tighter and tighter. A kind of repressive sense.
You know, in the next couple of months, this country is going to have it really hard. The next couple of years, maybe. But I do believe that if you do it in your own way, you have 2 years of hardship, and I really mean hardship, you might get out of it. We ain't started yet, right?
From 1977, We wrote it in the middle of last year. It was kind of like we just went on about the next year, you know, like in 1977, there's knives in West 11, you know, like people trying to rip you off, right? Like, lend me £2, man. And then there was like, but it ain't so lucky to be rich, because there's stain guns in Knightsbridge, you know, like.
Excuse me. You've got a right to film on these streets.
If I was going to Knightsbridge to rip off someone, I'd take a stain gun. Whereas I could probably rip someone off and not on your gate with a knife. Kids who come to see us, right, they'll get the suburban blues, don't they? You talk to them after a gig, they've got to go back to Crawley Newtown.
Basildon.
Basildon, yeah. And Crawley in a bathroom window or something like that.
The whole purpose of communication is to, like, move other people into action. I mean, if I'd moved one person, then it's enough.
I suppose we make albums and we sell them, right? We get loads of money. I mean, that's just going to fuck us up completely. You've got to know when it's time to give up.
Only time will tell. You just can't tell. Bands will withstand. If still in 4 years' time, The Clash are playing gigs that wipe you out, they're writing songs that are really honest, if they can do that, then the music will stay fresh.
From now on, right, watch our development, and you'll be able to see who owns what and what happens to a group of people when they provoke. You can either get bought by the Americans, taken by the English back to the 19th century, or left in oblivion as an anecdote. And that's what people are going to learn from what we do next. That's 1977 for me.
Covent Garden in the rain. The garden lies in a strange limbo nowadays, half astride its past, half stepping into its future. But it's not all that it seems. A whole new exotic community is moving into the garden, generating its own very special climate. Instant Tropicana in a banana warehouse.
It's a sanctuary because no man is allowed in here.
We're walking an economic high wire, and if somebody jerks the rope, then it makes it that much more difficult, but you've still got to get to the other side of the chasm.
What happens if we fall off the
rope? Oh, if we fall off, then we're in trouble.
Just a final word of reassurance. When we do leave here, we're going to be revitalised, our batteries recharged, and really, we'll be ready for anything.
We've got a whole array of young bands finding rock and roll meaningful now in this country, either by being in a band or by participating in a club and really feeling that they actually are part of something that they hope will transcend the music scene and give the power back to the kids.
Does someone want to cut the cake?
I'll cut it.
You cut it and I'll eat it.
Yankee! A detective! Her always on the TV! That's the cause of the murder! But every 10 seconds! I knew. I think I care about your boxy big ball shirt. I'd rather wear nothing than look like I'm ready to bat. I'm so bored with the USA. I'm so bored with the USA. What can I do? Ah.